Good afternoon, everyone. We are going to start the session, which will be in three parts, where the initial today's session is about sensitizing on approach to medical literature in general, and specifically looking at how we need to read, understand, interpret, and translate the content which is being published in scientific journals and other scientific materials, and how to translate it into practice. So for this sessions, we have planned the initial session with the Division of Research and subsequently the Medical Education Unit of Ramaiah Medical College. So we will have hands-on practical sessions for this. To begin the program, I request Dr. Shalini ma'am to say a few words of introduction and also set the agenda. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nandakumar and Dr. Akshay. Thank you. First of all, it's a little disappointing that there are only about 12 people who are participating in this, particularly because we know how important reading is. Not only reading journal articles and medical literature is for medical students and for doctors. So anyway, it's nice that at least 14 of you have joined now. And let me just start off by reiterating how important it is to read, okay? Whether it is reading fiction or reading a journal article, how important it is to read. So if you just think of the intangible benefits first, there are many, and you can, you know, there's a mnemonic called CHECK, which tells you the intangible benefits of reading, where C stands for communication. You improve your communication skills, whether it is writing skills or how to express yourself orally, that is a C. H stands for health. It improves your mental health. It is said to reduce stress. It is said to improve empathy. Okay, and it is said to improve memory also. And C stands for entertainment. Of course, many of us read for entertainment, which is an intangible benefit. I can't stress enough about the next C, that is again communication. And K stands for knowledge. You learn a lot when you read, whether it is medical literature or any books, any other type of books and reading material. And what are the tangible benefits that you would require? These benefits are knowledge which you would require in your career. You will have the authority to discuss with your peers. It will help you, you know, climb your steps in your career. So these are all very important benefits of reading, particularly medical literature. And therefore, the college has taken it upon itself to help you learn how to read journal articles. So as Dr. Nandakumar said, this will be in three sessions. Today will be the first session, followed by two more. So please make it a point to come for the next two sessions also, and please motivate your friends also to join in. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Session with evidence based medicine. Can I just speak slides and slides? Okay. For those of you who have joined in, let's just for the sake of interaction, to know that you have logged in and you are physically present there. One of the questions I asked, you can unmute and respond. So the first question is, like, most of us are aware that we have got a new strain of COVID-19 virus, which is the Omicron variant. So the question that I want to pose to you is, does remdesivir, the drug which was sort of like touted as the wonder drug, work effectively with the Omicron variant? Can one of you just unmute and say, is there a role for using remdesivir in the treatment of patients with the Omicron infection? Can one of you unmute, or I'll just call the name? Adil Thara?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Adil. Can you at least repeat the question so that we know that we are able to hear?
Sir, I heard the starting part and then I didn't hear, sir.
Yeah. So that is why I will repeat the question.
Does
remdesivir has a role in treating the Omicron variant of COVID-19? What is your opinion?
So when does what?
Remdesivir.
Yes, sir.
Will remdesivir work for Omicron variant?
Sir, I don't have a lot of knowledge, but I have not heard or not read any article that says so.
Okay. What about, like, this is another question.
All right, sir.
Papaya leaf extract is usually used for dengue patients, thinking that the platelet count increases if you give papaya leaf extract juice, or in fact, the Microlabs carry pill, which is a papaya leaf extract pill. So,
yes, sir. I've heard that.
You have heard that. So, will you be using it for your patients?
No, sir. Personally, I don't believe in that. But everyone is entitled to their own opinions. But I usually just believe in medicines, or so. It probably might work as well. You know, it might help in dengue patients. But personally, I don't believe in that. So, I will not be doing that.
Okay. Fine, Adil. Thanks for that.
Welcome,
so,
sir.
Can I request Ankita and Reddy to unmute, please?
Yes, Ankita. Sir.
Yeah. So, in terms of a particular treatment, suppose you make a diagnosis of a patient, and what determines the treatment?
Wait, I didn't get it.
How do you decide the treatment for a given disease?
Based on history.
Based on history. Okay, you have come to a diagnosis. You have known that it is like ischemic stroke. So, how do you go about like the treatment? What determines the life of treatment?
I don't know, sir.
I don't know, folks. Kiran, are you there?
Sir, yes, sir.
Kiran, how do we know that? Is it from the textbooks what we have determined the treatment, or your teachers have suggested something which makes the treatment? How is the treatment for a particular condition? What guides you for those treatments?
So, depending upon the symptoms with which the patient is present and few lab investigations.
Okay, fine. If something new is introduced, a medical representative comes and meets you guys in the OPD, say this is a wonder drug.
Okay.
For treating COVID-19. So, would you start using it?
So, as long as the tests are done and there is relevant, like proofs are there that it can provide after the tests and testings has been done, and if there's an article or government has advised, I will do that, sir, or else I won't.
Okay. So, just moving from what Adil told, Ankita attempted, and what Kiran is saying. So, the choice of treatment depends on body of evidence. When you are saying that tests are done, it refers to some empirical evidence for practice, which in recent times is called as evidence-based medicine. So, what we mean by evidence-based medicine is there is sufficient proof from scientific methods which empirically give in an unambiguous way that the treatment or a diagnostic approach or a standard operating protocol for a given disease condition has been verified irrefutably using standardized techniques in medical or health science research. This scientific approach has been the hallmark of modern medicine. And I say modern medicine, not necessarily the allopathic medicine. Any kind of scientific approach, including our indigenous systems of medicine like Ayurveda, Unani, relies on experimentation and finding proof. Nothing is done by means of just a hunch or, okay, let's try it kind of a thing. There is documentary and documented evidence for practice, which is what has evolved in recent times as evidence-based medicine. Most of you during your initial phases of MBBS, when we would have taught you epidemiology in community medicine and research methodology subsequently, you would have understood that while we are doing a scientific study or an epidemiological study, we look at observations. We see what is happening in the form of an exploratory study or ecological studies by which we are going to generate etiological hypothesis, which means that whenever a particular doctor sees that there is increase in cholesterol in this individual and there is a higher incidence of cardiac conditions, it could be a myocardial infarction or secondary to hypertriglyceridemia, some kind of manifestations can happen. This association is because of that observation. Once you have that observation, as in 10 patients, 20 patients, we have case series from these case reports, which forms the initial layer of evidence. Once you have this initial layer of evidence, we move on to analytical studies, which can be either cross case control study or cohort studies. The evidence that will be generated by these analytical studies will give an estimate of the risk that is associated with an exposure for a given outcome. So the evidence that we get from this next level, it is not just merely observation or an association, we are having a correlation by which we can predict it from the analytical studies. Once you have some kind of a proof, you can generate a hypothesis that hypertriglyceridemia leads to ABC. And from that design, we move on to what is called as experimental designs, where we have an intervention in the study arm and a control arm to see that whether the outcomes that we are witnessing can be attributed to a large extent to the interventions. So these studies are the experimental studies with randomization are the initial way in which we can assess the efficacy and effectiveness of a drug or an intervention in the management of diseases. But again, there will be certain biases. Biases refers to errors that creep in and bring in apparent associations when there are none. So when you have these biases in epidemiological studies, randomized controlled trials help you to overcome most of the biases. It can be either a selection bias, information bias, exposure ascertainment bias, or the outcome assessment bias. So these biases, if you are able to assess using a randomized control study and repeat it in different centers using the same protocol, multicentric RCTs are slightly better when it comes to getting this evidence for practice. In the last 2 or 3 decades, like from 90s and early 2000s, we have had what are called as systematic review or meta-analysis. So these are approaches where we take evidences from multiple randomized controlled trials. Using a standardized methodology, we try to synthesize or aggregate the evidence in such a way that the biases that would have crept in are neutralized or minimized to a large extent to give a definitive answer for medical practitioners to say that this treatment works most of the time for this condition in these different populations. That approach of synthesizing evidence is systematic review, which has been popularized by Cochrane Group, or the Cochrane system, which gives you standardized methods and tools for assessing this evidence. So in the workshops or the training that we are going to have, the whole idea is to glean or get that information from scientifically published articles, which are in journals. A journal is a scientific document which will be brought by either a specialized group. You have many of the specialties bringing out their own journals, or it can be a publisher who have a process of peer review. Specialists in that field review that, edit it, and give you the essence of research which can be used for practice. So the whole idea is, whenever somebody asks you whether this treatment works in this particular disease, it's not a hunch, it's not just a belief system, or it's not that, okay, I think so kind of a thing. Today, you need to have irrefutable proof, which is there in the form of evidence, which has been graded, and the EBM, the entire evidence-based medicine, stands on. So in that context, where you get the source of information, its credibility, validity, relevance, and utility for decision making is extremely important. In this context, unless you are trained to read the literature and assess its methodological robustness in delivering that evidence, it would be very difficult for you to sort of like differentiate between chalk and cheese. The reason being, there are more than 1 lakh, or infinite number of journals which claim to provide this medical evidence. And each year we are flooded with new online materials which are there in many of these commercial websites, with .coms and health being the flavor of the season. Everybody tends to give their opinion. So how do we know that what is the truth, what is from a credible source, and what are the things that you need to look for, is what the whole training is all about. In this context, one of the material which is will be very useful from a learning point of view are the series which have been written by one Dr. Chita Greenhalgh. In the British Medical Journal, there is a series, and I just googled it. The book is also available as a PDF in Google Books. How to Read a Paper by Trisha Greenhalgh from British Medical Journal, BMJ Publications. So here she goes through the various phases of appraising clinical literature, which probably in the next few sessions will give you overview of. But the book per se and the chapters, each type of study design, how to look at it, what are the things that you need to see for, and how to know whether the evidence has been presented in an unambiguous, correct manner, is what this series talks about. So I'm going to stop here. Just to summarize and recap, assessing evidence from scientific literature is an important and integral skill as a medical graduate will be required to do. This is one of the desired and essential competencies in the new NMC thing for people to, medical graduates to have. And for this, unless you get trained, unless you're doing it on a routine, it will be difficult to understand what the relative risks are, confidence intervals, how the study design has been given in a journal. So it would be difficult. So what we are going to do is walk you through the theory part of it as to what are the components you need to look for. But more importantly, we'll be having hands-on exercises where an article or some material would be given for you to go through and present it. So the next session is by Dr. Akshay, who is going to sort of walk you through some of these things. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. As all our dear interns
programs or sessions that will be held as part of this workshop, online workshop. Train all of you participants. For talk and knowledge. It's different from reading traditional textbooks, which you have been doing so far. So we expect at an advanced level for textbooks. Source of information, but more and more reliance on getting information or extracting information from published literature and articles online. That all graduates, like Mukumasar said, be aware of how they can from journal articles, whether it's published as online or online. Medical graduate, why should I be reading journal articles, or why do I need to, how to interpret journal articles? This could be for a variety of reasons. So although textbooks are a very good source of information, but what we need to realize is a lot of mixed information within the textbooks. So even if an author who has written the entire book, he would have that information from journal articles, and he would have summarized all that information without necessarily providing the evidence or the basis for all of that information. So whenever a particular topic needs to be read up about, you could also choose a textbook, but the information is likely to be slightly outdated, but slightly out of the recent development. So it may not contain all student concepts in that particular field or that particular topic. Therefore, even if one wanted to know a little more in depth about the theoretical aspects of a particular topic, apart from textbooks, could also refer to case series or case reports, individual topics or individual diagnostic therapeutic procedure, and so on. The other reason why one would want to search for articles at your level as an intern would be maybe if you were trying to think of conducting a research study of your own. So in that case, you would want to go through original articles as well as clinical trials, whether they be run controlled non-randomized controlled, as well as observational studies where there's no intervention, but case control, as well as cross-sectional studies. Finally, if you wanted in-depth information about a particular topic, would want to read up either a narrative or systematic review and meta-analysis. So these can be a very good source of information, meta-analysis. In fact, they are considered as the best source of information with the highest reliability in terms of evidence. A brief recap about what are the different designs for studies when they are conducted. This is important because when you want to apply a checklist, when you want to use a checklist to try and decide whether the information, try and interpret the information that is there, you would want to know what the design of the study is. So any epidemiological study, if the investigator is assigning an intervention, then it becomes an experimental study. Again, whether it is a randomized allocation of the intervention or is it non-randomized, decides whether it's an RCT or a non-randomized clinical trial. If in case it is just an observational study, in the sense there is no intervention that is being assigned by the investigator, he is just allowing the phenomena of the events without having any interventions from the side, then it becomes an observational study. And depending on whether there is a comparison group or not, if there is no comparison group, it would just become a descriptive study. For example, if I wanted to estimate the prevalence of anemia in pregnancy, so if I wanted to check if how many of pregnant ladies have anemia, so that would become just a descriptive study where I'm not comparing
factors within that particular study population. But in case there is a comparison that I am doing, then that becomes an analytical scale. So if in case I wanted to know the determinants or the factors responsible or the factors associated with anemia in pregnancy, then I would be comparing pregnant ladies versus non-anemic pregnant ladies. That would become an analytical study by the comparator group. So again, these can be of different types based on the direction of the exposure. In case we start with the exposure and follow up the patients till the outcome, then that becomes a prospective study, and it's also known as a cohort study. The cohort is where the entire study population, right from exposure till the outcome, the occurrence of the outcome, they are entirely followed up. Whereas in case we find patients who already have developed that outcome, and then retrospectively go back and analyze what may be the factors that were common or not common, developed outcome versus the patients who don't develop that particular outcome, that becomes, that means basically you're going from the outcome and then going back and exploring possible exposure factors, that becomes a case control study. So compare those with the outcome without, and against those without the outcome, explore retrospectively what factors were common or importantly not common. In case the exposure and outcome occur at the same time, then that is known as a cross-sectional study. Now many of you will be very familiar with the cross-sectional study because that research is a attempted and carried out studies. So cross-sectional study does happen to be one of the most popular designs because of the ease with which it can be executed. Cross-sectional study design is when the exposure outcome have the same type. Now, in terms of literature, when we are assessing literature, one important thing to know is based on the recommendation, or based on basically the message or the take-home message from that particular article, the level of evidence is decided by what kind of article it was, what kind of study or publication it was. So the least level of evidence would be a narrative review or expert opinions or editorial articles where there may not be much as much scientific backing or background for that particular author's conclusions. It may be a conclusion that is given out by experience. It may be an exclusion that is deduced by logic, but without any actual evidence. So something which is without analytic support, that becomes the least level of evidence, that is level 5. Level 4 would be where either individual cases, the case reports, or similar cases are studied and the conclusion is given out. That becomes a case series. That would be level 4. And case control studies, like I said, the exposure, the outcome is first. Patient with outcome are compared with patients without the outcome in terms of what are the factors which are not between the two. That becomes level 3, case control studies. Studies where the study population is followed up prospectively. That becomes level 2. And the highest level of evidence is generally considered for articles which contain systematic reviews, randomized clinical trials, and meta-analysis. Meta-analysis would biased assessment of pool or multiple studies is done, where the results of different trials are assimilated into one article. That is analysis, which generally forms the basis of providing or formulating clinical guidelines also. These are generally considered as articles with highest level of evidence. For all of you, if you were to be to start reading a journal article, what would be the some of the steps involved? The first thing is to get you want to select the journal. You want to get that right. You want to make sure that the journal from where you're selecting that particular article, you're searching for a particular article, is credible. What are the credentials of the journal? So nowadays, of course, most journals are online. So that becomes somewhat of a problem, because any web page online could claim to be a journal, could have or display articles on that page, but in fact they may not be actually peer-reviewed journals. They may be predatory journals or predatory websites, which may be just uploading the article online in exchange for a fee from the authors. So of course, not just for reading, even though it's submitting your journal articles or studies, careful about selecting the particular journal which you are submitting to. So some of the points help you in deciding whether the journal is reliable or not. At your level, you can of course recognize the name of the journal. So many of you would have already heard of very famous journals like NEJM or British Medical Journal, PMJ. So very popular, Lancet, very popular journals, of course, don't need much background search. Just the names can tell you whether they're reliable journals or not. But what about those which are not so well known and yet may be reliable? One of the ways which you can find out that is not deciding about by identifying the indexing. Indexing is the database within which these journals have been put in. So one of the most famous and reliable databases is PubMed, which many of you know, have heard of PubMed, which is a very large database, the journal is indexed in PubMed, then it can be taken as a reliable. One of the ways to decide if it is reliable is PubMed. There are similar other indexing agencies you can also take as Focus or Web of Science. The other aspect is peer review. So you can, unless a journal is peer reviewed, that means that all articles submitted to the undergo assessment by similar or experts from field through a rigorous process of scrutiny, then an article published without such scrutiny would not carry so much value. So if an article or if a journal is not predatory, they would have a robust peer review system that can also, if in case the article or the journal does not disclose its peer review process, does not display the names of their editors, or does not display details of the acceptance dates or the time taken for the peer review process clearly, then you have to doubt whether it happened or not. And of course, you could go through the previous volume, the previous editions of that particular journal to see if the articles published are reliable or not. So of course, at the beginning, it's not so easy. It's like swimming. So when you start reading articles from journals, it's not going to be easy. But as you do it repeatedly, as it becomes a practice, it'll start coming easily. In a very short way, what you could do is start out by reading the title. Now you're looking for a particular article, like I said, maybe it's for getting information, you can think of a topic for research. Then you want to look at the title first. So any journal would be having a title which is highlighted, and if the title seems to have the content or seems to reflect that, yes, this is the topic which I wanted to read about, then start proceeding further. In case the title does not seem to suggest what you wanted to look for, then you may have to search for further articles. I mean, keywords also help. There's always a type journal or article would be also carry keywords mentioned below the title. And if the keywords are included in your particular area of interest, then you would proceed further. Next, after the title, you'd want to read the abstract. So many journals provide an abstract of the entire study. So sometimes some of these articles may run into 20 pages. So any article would want to carry an abstract or a summary of that particular entire article, which can be read in a short space of time. Most of the journals insist on abstracts which are less than 250 words, sometimes 200, sometimes 150. Most often, 250 is the limit. So within 250 words, if the article can be well summarized, and that's how they also emphasize to the author of the article, that the article should be well summarized within these many words, so that maximum amount of information is given to the reader in the abstract itself within those many words. So if the abstract seems appealing, seems to suggest that yes, this particular entire article would help to give you the information you are looking for, then you would proceed. And you would want to look at the aims and the objectives. You want to look at the methodology. You would also want to look at whether the reasoning was correct for the hypothesis based on which the research was carried out. And also you want to look at the conclusions. If you feel the abstract does seem to suggest the contents are correct, then you would want to proceed to the entire article. Of course, even if it is a 25-page article, you need not have to read everything. So one more approach for interpreting the abstract is the PICO approach. It is very popular, especially for beginners. It can be very useful. The PICO approach is something that you can employ when you are starting to learn. PICO stands, it's an abbreviation, stands for participants, I is intervention, C for comparator, and O for outcomes. So as an example, so this is an abstract from a very, very famous study based on dexamethasone in COVID-19. If we have to locate the PICO, that is P-I-C-O, P is for participants, so we need to find out how many participants and what exactly were they, what was the common trait or what qualities for the participants in this particular study. You will notice that these are the number of participants, a total of 1,104 patients who, along with 4,321 experts. So basically, somewhere close to 6,400 participants, 6,425 participants with study. What was common about them? All of them were hospitalized with COVID-19. So this is P. P in this particular abstract would be 6,425 patients who were hospitalized with COVID-19. What was the intervention that was done in these many participants? There were some who received oral or intravenous dexamethasone. So this was the intervention. The intervention in this abstract study was the administration of dexamethasone. And what was the comparator group? What was dexamethasone compared against? Was it compared against another drug? No, it was to usual care. So usual care versus dexamethasone, not a specific comparator, just usual care. And finally, outcome. What was the outcome and how was it measured? Shows that the primary outcome was 28-day mortality, and it showed the 482, that's 22.9% of patients in the dexamethasone group, while 25.7% of the care group died within 28 days. So clearly, and if you look at the end of the sentence, there's something called T less than 0.001. A little bit of statistical knowledge is also important. I'm sure you all know from your community medicine, the P value less than 0.0 can be considered as significant. But how that P value was arrived at and whether the statistical methods used were correct or appropriate, all that is something that needs to be taken look at, but that will be discussed further. Just as an overview, if you see that the P value, yes, it was difference of significant, 25.7%. This is an example for use of the PICO approach when you are assessing an abstract of a particular article. Finally, the checklists that are different checklists that are employed when these checklists are not just for interpretation of articles, it's also for when you are author is writing up the article, So for observational studies, generally the strobe checklist is used, whereas for systemic reviews and meta-analysis, the PRISMA. And finally, for case control trial, the CONSORT checklist. So I'll just display the strobe checklist. Now, since observational studies, especially the cross-sectional studies, are the most common study design employed by our students as well as familiar with them. So we'll discuss only the strobe checklist. Initially, right from the title and abstract into the introduction, methods, results, observation, discussion, as well as conclusions. So all these need to be assessed using this checklist. One thing you can remember is MRAD, IMRAD. So these are this is the short form for the different subheadings or sections within a particular article. So I is for introduction, M is for methods. The methodology also, different aspects need to be looked at. R is for results, T is for discussion. All these aspects have their own subheadings need to be assessed. And this is a checklist that is not just useful for interpretation, but it's also useful for writing up a particular article. Similar, this is for observational study. So, strobe is for, whereas PRISMA is for analysis, consult for, I know it's not easy for any one session to cover a topic which you have not been exposed to throughout your English study. But this session or this today's mainly for all of you for the subsequent workshop we conducted in the for the next talk, I'd like to invite Pratesh, he is the assistant professor. Samples of power stroke checklist can be applied on professional studies. Meantime, if there are any doubts, please put it up in your chat.
Everybody, are my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, Akshay sir has already discussed as to what exactly is the strobe checklist. Today, we are just going to be looking at one particular article for which we can apply the strobe checklist. So, what we do in the PG curriculum is we have something called as journal review of the journal club. Okay. So, in the journal club, what we do is one particular journal article is selected. And that will be presented. This is one of the examples of a journal review by one of our PGs. So what our PG has done is they will review that entire article. The title of this article is Clinical Efficacy and Safety of Tocilizumab in the Treatment of Seropositive Rheumatoid Arthritis Patients in India. So this is the title of the journal article. And these are the authors. Kumar A, Rakuni D S, Shanmugam, Nandan K, Hegde A, Vasudev, Arjunan M, and et al. So generally, we use et al. Means after six authors, et al. Means there are others also. And the journal from which this is taken is Indian Journal of Rheumatology. And this is the year of publication. 2020 is the year of publication. Issue volume 15 or issue 15, pages 286 to 91. Now, why am I stressing on this? Okay, the way this is written, this is generally called as the referencing style. So whenever we have to mention, okay, supposing you are writing a journal article and you want to quote it somewhere, you have taken some data from, if I have taken the data from this journal, how will I quote it from where have I taken this reference, okay? This is the style of quoting. And the various styles of quoting, one of the most common styles with which we quote is what is called as the Vancouver style of referencing. In the Vancouver style of referencing, it is written like this, and how it appears is as and when the in the article, you put it as a reference one. Supposing I've taken the first reference from this article and put it as number one, and this is the style in which it will be written. The other style of referencing is what we call as a Harvard style. In the Harvard style, what happens is the author's name along with the year of publication, that will just be written, okay, the date and the year. So that is called as the Harvard style. There are many other styles, but generally these are two of the most common styles of referencing. The next thing, as sir already mentioned, before you start out, okay, you are like wanting to do research, you go into PubMed Central or any of the databases, the first thing you do is you put in your type words, search words, keywords, and when you get the article, you're going to be first looking at the abstract. You cannot read like if it's a big article, say if it's like 20 pages, 30 pages, or even if it's like 7 pages, you cannot read 7 pages to see whether it's worth our time. Equally look at the abstract. And this is how the abstract goes. So this article, in the abstract, what is given is you have the background. The background says it's a receptor antibody which competitively inhibits signal transduction. So that is the background why we have used this particular drug. Next, what is the objective? Why are we doing this study? Okay, to find the clinical efficacy and safety of this tocilizumab in Indian patients with seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. That is the objective. Next is the patients and methods. So who are the patients and what are you going to do with these patients? That is the next thing. So this is a prospective observational single center study at a tertiary rheumatology center, tertiary care rheumatology center. So what do you mean by prospective? Prospective means that I am going to recruit the patient after the ethical clearance. That is, before any study is done, there is something called as the institutional ethical committee from which you have to present your study. So many people who have done these student projects will know that you will have to present it in front of a scientific committee. So basically what they do is they will look at whether there are any ethical issues, any legal issues, any social issues in it. And if not, if it is there, they will approve your study and they will give you a letter of acceptance saying that you can do it from this period to this period. Say I want to do this study, they will give me an ethical clearance certificate from January 2022 up to December 2022. Maybe I will say I am going to recruit patients for 1 year. So that will be a prospective study. Another type of study is what is a retrospective study. Supposing I already have some data of the rheumatoid arthritis patients and I want to take the data from that, okay? So I will just look at the patient case files or the records. Retrospective data, that is already the data is collected. I am just referencing, taking back from what is already there. So that is a retrospective study. And it's an observational single center study. Usually there are trials wherein you have more than one center. For example, if it's a clinical trial, what they do is not only in one population, they will look at globally, because if the drug has to be marketed globally, you need to test it on all ethnicities so that you know how it works in each particular ethnicity. So what you do is you will do it in multiple centers, so that will be part of a multi-centric study. Now, because this is done in one center, it's a single center study. And here, look at this. More all the patients are greater than 16 years of age. Now, why is age very important? More than 18 years of age is an adult. Okay, so it's very simple. You take a written informed consent, which will even be recorded. Okay, remember before starting any study, even if it's a retrospective study, even if you're just doing an analysis on the patient's blood sample, you have to take a consent from that patient saying that your blood sample or we are going to be using this data, whatever we take in the study, and they have to sign that written informed consent. Illiterate, it should be in a language which they can understand. Okay, that is the consent. Now, this person is here, it says 16 years of age and above. So, whenever trials are done in patients below 18 years of age, generally greater than 6 years of age up to 18 years of age is something called as assent, okay? Because generally, 6 to 18 years, what happens is they cannot give full consent, but then they do understand the nature of what they are going through. So, what they do is the parental consent or the guardian consent, legal guardian consent is taken along with the consent of that particular person who is being recruited in the trial. So, that is called as assent. And also, in the pediatric trial, suppose the neonatal trial, the parents' consent will be taken. And these are the things. Okay, so they are going to estimate the disease activity based on the DAS-28 score, and they are going to look at the ESR. And then also, they are going to administer 6 doses of tocilizumab. So this will tell you that 6 doses will be given, and they are going to analyze what is the improvement in this score or what happens following the 6 doses. Next, looking at the results, also 30 patients were enrolled in this trial, and then they say that the score has improved. Okay, from the baseline score, it has improved from 5.03 improved to 2.4, and p value is less than 0.005. So this less than 0.005 means it is statistically significant. That means that when you do this trial 100 times, 95% of the time you can replicate this one, it is very clinically significant. That's what it means. Okay. And they've also written that no serious adverse effect was noted in any of the patients. And then the conclusion is it is an effective and safe option for the treatment of seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. So this is just the abstract of the study. Then going to this thing, so this is how they start off. Okay, the introduction will tell you, whenever you write an article, the first thing is, this is a study for rheumatoid arthritis. You generally begin with, what is rheumatoid arthritis? It is an inflammatory arthritis characterized by persistent synovitis and all of that. So you generally describe the disease. Next, you describe the treatment. What are you giving here? You are giving TMARDS, okay? That is a conventional therapy. So this is the biological disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drug. So you describe that. You describe the treatment which you are going to give. So all this you write in the introduction of your study. Now remember, whenever you use abbreviations, all the abbreviations, the first time you use the abbreviation in an article, it should be exhaustive. There's something called BDMARDS. So BDMARDS stands for biological disease modifying anti-rheumatoid drugs. Okay. And that is the tocilizumab which you are giving. And it is found to have exert multifaceted immunogenic effects on the T cell, B cell proliferation and antibody production. Basically, you tell how exactly this drug is going to act. Okay, then again, it says the clinical efficacy and safety of this drug in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis in patients who are failed to respond to conventional synthetic DMARDs. So, CSDMARDs stands for conventional synthetic DMARDs as well as other classes of biologicals. So, why are you giving this drug? So, whenever you do a trial or do a study, you will have to justify why you are doing it, okay? You can say that either this is a normal study, nobody has done it, but every time that is not possible. So maybe you're doing it in a population. In your population, there are not many trials which have evidence that this drug works well in that population. So you want to do it in your setup. Okay, maybe in South Asia it's not done, in South India it's not done. So we want to know what is the way it works in our population. So that can be your justification as to why you're conducting this study. Okay, that is one thing. Next is the objective. So every study of yours, you will have an objective. For example, this objective was to find the clinical efficacy and safety of tocilizumab in Indian patients of seropositive rheumatoid arthritis. So that is what you are trying to do in this study. So what the patients and method, I already told you the prospective observation, single-centered study done at a tertiary care center and 30 patients. Okay. Now, if you remember, the study in Dr. Asher told that had thousands of patients. Remember, in every study, you need not have thousands of patients, okay? If it's a very rare disease or not such a common thing. See, these biologicals are quite expensive drugs, so we may not be able to, it's not like dexamethasone, which can be easily given. Or if it's a newer drug, you cannot hold on thousands of patients at a stretch, okay? You need to start off with a small group, okay? So you are only 30 patients have been recruited. So always keep in mind, a study need not always have thousands or lakhs of patients. It can even have like 30 patients, 50 patients, 100 patients, depending upon the condition, right? So that is one more thing which you should, right? So these patients should fulfill this classification criteria, and more than 16 years of age, they were recruited from the rheumatology OPD as well as from the inpatients admitted at this particular time frame. So they were always telling what is the time frame. Here they required quite a long time, from December 2014 to February 2017, they have recruited patients for this study. And remember, institutional ethical committee and scientific committee approval should be obtained for all studies, both in the state, and written informed consent for participation was also obtained. So as I told you, if the participant is illiterate or cannot understand, they should be able to understand what is going to happen in their regional language, in a language in which they can understand. And remember, no study will be forced upon any patient, and every person has a right to withdraw from the study at any point. If they say that I'm going to quit the study halfway through, you cannot tell them, no, you have already come, you have to go, or I will not treat you because you won't come, you cannot do any of that. okay, the patient can keep intermittent any point of time. They will be given some honorarium amount just for the travel and all of that, but not for luring them into the study. So that is one thing which you have to be very clear. It is fully, the patient is fully aware and fully consenting to the study. I told you, right, even if you're taking a sample report or anything, for that also they should fully consent for your study. You can't do anything without the consent. Then this is a very important thing. In every study you will have an inclusion and an exclusion criteria. Now what comes under the inclusion criteria is who are you going to take? Now you know the rheumatoid arthritis. So are you going to take everyone with rheumatoid arthritis? Okay, if you're going to take patients of any other class of biological DMARDs who have had active disease after at least 3 months of treatment approved at doses, so they are also included in this study. So what are the exclusion criteria? The inclusion criteria here, it says that 16 years and above. So anybody who's below the 16 years of age will not be excluded. So who else should you not take? Patients with active infection or cytopenia, those who are pregnant and lactating. Generally, in many trials, this is one clause. Pregnant and lactating women will not be taken in any trial until unless it is specifically designed for pregnant and lactating women. See, for example, even the COVID vaccine, right, in the beginning, they gave everybody, but they were not sure about pregnant women. Why? Because initially, when a new drug comes out or new vaccine comes out, okay, you don't test it on the vulnerable population like a pregnancy or lactation or, you know, elderly or pediatric population. See, even now, India, we have not approved. We don't have any vaccine yet. There are only kinds of vaccine in the market that will request for children. That is because we generally test it on healthy volunteers, okay? And all that, and after it is proven to be safe, and then we will test it in special population. So that is why most of the studies, you will know that pregnancy lactation will be an exclusion criteria. One question specifically, if you are doing a trial for pregnant and lactating women, they will be included. Always keep in mind, this will be an exclusion criteria in most of your studies, okay? And earlier, they have told patients with active evidence of hepatitis B, C infection, raised transaminase levels greater than 1.5 times the normal, and latent TB. So these are the exclusion criteria for this particular trial. And okay, this is what is given. Patients were given injection tocilizumab 8 milligrams per kg through IV route every month for 6 months. So what are you administering? So every month for 6 months, once a month, you're going to give this injection. And what are you assessing after giving the injection? First, you do a baseline, okay? Baseline laboratory evaluation. That means even before the patient takes the first injection, you're going to evaluate all of this. So what are you evaluating? ESR, C-reactive protein, complete blood count, liver function test, and lipid profile. So this you will do at the first visit, that is a zero visit before taking any drug. Then after that is a baseline, parameters. Then you do the same thing at 4 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 16 weeks, 20 and 24 weeks. So at every interval, we're going to take all of these blood tests. And rheumatoid factor and CRP, they were done using this nephrometry, and cutoff value was 20 and 10, okay? Now, another important thing in any journal will be your statistics. Now, I have all this data, I have collected all the baseline values, I have collected 4 weeks, 8 weeks, and all. So, what am I going to do with all those values? I am going to apply for the statistical test and then see whether it has any significance. That is, by using a statistical test, what you are trying to prove is, supposing the person I have given this tocilizumab, is there actually any significant improvement with tocilizumab? Or even without this drug, what would be the case? Okay, whether actually this drug has any significance, like significant improvement in the course of the disease, that is what we are looking at. So here, univariate analysis. So univariate analysis, such as frequency, mean, and standard deviation, range, they were performed. So these are what we call as baseline characteristics. Okay. So all this was done. Then we use paired t-test and chi-square. These are some of the common tests which we use. And all analysis, they were performed using Stata version. Okay. So this is the statistical software version, STATA version 12.0. So this is the statistical software package which we use to analyze these results. And a two-side p less than 0.05 was used to indicate statistical significance. That means if the p-value is less than 0.05, it means that it is significant. That is, this particular treatment has a significant effect on the outcome. And results, So basically, whenever you do, you will generally have charts like these. So this is what we do is, for every study, you will put a baseline characteristics table. That is, you have recruited patients, some 30 patients are there. What are the mean age of the patient? So can you see here, age in years is 44. So how long are they suffering from rheumatoid arthritis? Average mean duration is 9.4 years. Okay, and all of these are the baseline parameters. Next, what are the drugs? Okay, and so you have hydroxychloroquine, methotrexate, deflunomide, sulfasalazine, prednisolone. These are the drugs, and some have even received combination of drugs like methotrexate plus sulfasalazine plus hydroxychloroquine. So all of these, and what are the previous DMRs which were used, like infliximab, etanercept? All of these are the baseline characteristics. That is, even before they came into the trial, this is what was their baseline parameter. Next, they put some graphs like this. So always, everybody, we cannot into small tables and understand. So anything you can pictorically represent. So this is what we call as a bar diagram. Okay, so this will look at the blue, all the blue bars. Can you see all the blue bars? The blue bars basically indicate this tocilizumab. Okay, and then the red one is for your SJC. That is a swollen joint count. Okay, the TJC stands for your tender joint count. So this graph again represents the number of patients in different strata of the disease at the baseline and during therapy. So generally, what you do is you put the score, okay, at the baseline at 0 weeks, and the patient has first come and got recruited into the trial. What was their score? Now at 4 weeks, I have given one injection of tocilizumab. After 4 weeks, what is happening? After 8 weeks, and finally at 24 weeks, am I seeing anything? Okay, can you see this purple line, this remission? So many patients have had remission. Okay, that means that your drug is working. So what was at 4 weeks, can you make out this purple bar? You can see that it has slowly sort of increased. Okay, with every month of giving this tocilizumab, you find that many people are going to remission, they are getting better. So obviously this drug is working. So when you put in graphs like these, okay, this is just one graph, there are multiple graphs, there's something called scatter plot and so many other things, forest plot. All these things will basically tell you in one picture. Now, looking at the table may be hard, but if I look at this, I know that, okay, these patients have improved. That means that this drug is working. So definitely, every article should contain a couple of graphs so that the person reading your article will come to know pictorically in a very simple method that this drug has worked or not, or what is exactly the significance. Now remember, in every trial, you screen a couple of patients. Supposing my sample size is 30, I have to screen from 40 patients. Why? Because a couple of them may drop out. Like I told you right in the exclusion criteria, some patient may have hepatitis B, some will have hepatitis C, some patient may just withdraw from consent, some will be lost to follow-up. That is, you will recruit a patient. You expect them to come at 1 month, 2 months and all that. Some patients will come for 2 months, then they'll go somewhere, they'll tell, oh, I went off to my village, all of that. So many things will be there. Multiple reasons, they can have some personal issues, okay? They may not be able to come, so they will be lost to follow-up. So whenever you calculate a sample size, you give a buffer for all of that, and then slightly, you will screen more patients and recruit slightly more patients so that at the end of the day, your number of patients will still produce a significant result. Remember, you cannot do a trial just with one or two patients, okay? Because it should have some significance, because what has worked in one or two people may not really translate to a bigger population. So always keep that in mind. You always give a buffer for all these dropouts and all, and then you will have to calculate the sample size. And then here we are looking at the efficacy and safety. So the safety means you're looking at the adverse effect profile. Here they say there were no serious adverse effects requiring withdrawal of therapy. Okay, if there's any serious adverse effect that is very highly elevated, transaminases more than 3 times, 5 times the normal, then it will stop the drug or stop this, withdraw the patient from the treatment. So all that didn't happen. And the 4 patients suffered from non-serious infections. Here they only mentioned that if they had tuberculosis, they will not take them. So they had non-serious infections. Which infections? They didn't particularly mention. See, they have written skin infection and respiratory and herpes zoster. And the 6 patients had raised ALT, and all of them had AST/ALT levels less than 3 times the upper limit of normal, which they have considered as okay for this study. So then you will have something called as a discussion. In a discussion of the trial, what you do is all these results what you have got, you will try to interpret it with other studies, similar studies to this. Somebody else may have done a study with tocilizumab, okay? So whether those studies also have similar results or is it different, it's not always necessary that you should get a positive result, like you should tell that this drug is better, nothing like that. Okay, you can even tell that this drug didn't work, or sometimes in the worst case scenario, the drug produced an adverse this thing, it made the disease worse. See, remember, every study will get published, okay? That is why it's very important for you to it's not always necessary for you to publish that this drug is always better, nothing like that. Anything can be done, and that is why here in the discussion you say that tocilizumab has already been established as an efficacious biological DMARD for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis in patients with inadequate response to the conventional ones or different biologicals. However, there is a lack of data on the use of tocilizumab in India, so that is why we have done this trial. And here also they have similar results. They have found that it is quite efficacious. Okay, so this is the again bar graph showing the clinical efficacy of this drug. Okay, and the safety also has been quite remarkable. That is what the study says. So in conclusion, they say that it's a useful biological, which is which is used in the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis in patients who are refractory to other conventional or other biologicals with a reasonably good safety profile. And this is one thing which is very important. Any journal article, in the end, they should look at the financial support and sponsorship. Okay, supposing if it's a clinical trial, mostly the pharma company will sponsor that trial. Okay, so in that case, there may be a bias or there may be a conflict of interest. Conflict of interest is something like an internal evaluation kind of a thing. Like, see, supposing if you are our college students, in our internal assessment, we'll put marks for you, okay? We are your internals. But in the externals, why do we call some other external examiner? That is because we are our students. They feel that we may have some bias. So we will generally pass our students. So they really want to know whether they are worthy of passing. So they will call an external person, okay? So that external person has no conflict of interest. So they don't know who you are. They have no idea about this. What they will do is, classes you for what you are. So that is avoiding conflict of interest. Conflict of interest here means that I know what the students are. This is just an example. It's not exactly what it is. What I'm trying to tell you is, if a company is sponsoring that particular drug, they may have a pressure to tell that drug is better. So if that company tells it, and if a third party also does a trial with that drug, but it's not involved in that, then that third party thing is much more reliable, because they are not under any pressure to tell that this drug is working better, right? So that conflict of interest, if any, should be declared. Supposing you are getting a fund from that company, that should be declared that this was funded. It's not wrong to fund it, but it should be declared. Okay, saying that we have no conflict of interest. That is what these people say. And if there's any financial support or sponsorship, that has to be mentioned. Also, if you're using a couple of scales and all that, right, sometimes you may have to take a permission from the person who has used that scale. Some will be in public domain. If it is not, then you will have to take permission and use a couple of things. And generally, you will have to mention what software is used, and for the analysis, for the blood test, what is done, what are the machines which have been used, all of that, everything should be mentioned in your article. Now, looking at all this, we come to what is the strength and the weakness of the study. So the strength, sometimes the authors themselves will tell you, this is the strength of our study and this is the weakness of our study. Otherwise, what we do is we generally analyze based on the slope list. So they say that it's a novel study. It's unique for being one of the first studies to report the clinical efficacy and safety in Indian patients. That's what they claim. And the limitations are, it's a very small sample size. Only 30 patients they have done. So you need to follow it up with a larger population. And not generalizable. So I told you, right, it's a single center study. So you cannot generalize it to the entire global population until you have done a multicentric study. And the title of the study, it does not indicate the study design. If you look at the title, 1 minute. See, if you look at the title, it just says clinical efficacy and safety of tocilizumab in the treatment of seropositive RA patients in India. That's all. Okay, you don't know whether it's a cross-sectional, prospective, observational, retrospective. So we don't know. So that usually in a good study, they will tell you whether it's an observational study, cross-sectional study, it's a randomized controlled trial, whatever it is, it should be mentioned. So that has not been mentioned in this title of the study. And assent, consent has not been mentioned. I told you, right, if a person is less than 18 years of age, assent along with the consent has to be taken. That is a that person also should give consent along with the parent or the legal guardian. That has not been mentioned again. That should have definitely been taken, though it must have been taken, but they have not mentioned it. That is also one of the negative or limitations of the study. So now coming to the stroke checklist. So as sir had projected, the stroke checklist is the same thing. See, the title and abstract we have put on cross. So what does it mean? It does not tell you the study design. So we have put a cross. Next, again in the participants, okay, a couple of things are not mentioned. So that has been crossed. So what you do is at the end of your journal, once you read it, you keep the stroke checklist and then you put a tick for whatever parameters are there and put a cross for what parameters are not there. So this is how you will analyze any particular journal article. Okay. And as I said, stroke is only for observational studies. You have the consort checklist, the Prisma checklist, and there's something called as the ARIVE checklist for animal studies. Okay. And there's a CARE checklist for just case reports. Okay, so like a single case report, maybe there's like a specific adverse reaction or a new variation in a new like a new syndrome or something like that. That will be just done as a case report or a case series. For that, you have the CARE checklist. So based on the type of study, you will put this checklist beside you and see. Okay, so generally, if it fulfills most of the criteria, it means that it's a good study. And finally, you look at the references. Okay, now this, as I told you, is the Vancouver style of referencing. So please, at the end of today, at least get to know the styles of referencing. The most commonly used, okay, that's why I told you, those who have done these student projects will know, generally we prefer the Vancouver style of referencing. So go and see what is the Vancouver style of referencing. So how the references appear is how they appear in the journal article. So first, the names of the authors will be given, the name of the journal, and then the year in which it is published, the issue volume number and the page number. So this is the Vancouver style of referencing. Okay, as I told you, Vancouver style is covered. There are multiple styles, but most commonly dissertations and most of the journals, they ask for the Vancouver style of referencing. So with this, I have come to the end of my talk. So if there are any doubts or any questions, very briefly I have discussed one article. So what all of y'all can do is, y'all can go to PubMed Central and just download any one article, okay? Download an article, let it be an observational study. Now y'all are familiar with the stroke checklist. You type in stroke checklist in Google itself, you'll get the stroke checklist. So what you do is, first you read the abstract. If it's good enough, okay, if you think it is good enough, you take that whole article, then you keep this stroke checklist and all the points which I have mentioned, right? So you either put a tick or you put a cross if it is not there. It will be difficult in the beginning, but then, I mean, you can just make a start. At least now, if you do not know how to analyze, you at least know that these things should be there in a journal. So with this, we'll take it from here. If there are any doubts or questions, please feel free to type it in the chat. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rathi ma'am. So I hope this session has been useful in the form of being, like I said, an introductory or a sensitization session. We will have, actually we wanted to have it as an offline session, but because of the current advisory to avoid any additional academic activities due to the COVID restrictions, we've had to have it as an online on this online platform. We will have a much larger workshop where we will have active participation from all of you next week. So 23rd of December, we will be doing it at a much larger scale. This is just an introductory session, but in case anyone has any doubts, you can please you can unmute and ask also, or you can type in into the chat box. We'd be happy to answer them.
At least y'all can tell, did y'all understand anything? Do you at least know how to search for a journal, something at least, so that we know that you have at least been hearing to, you know, something what we have told? Anybody?
Any feedbacks at all?
Were you aware of all these terms? I mean, this is just for us to know, like, what is your level?
Thanks for the feedback, Vishnu. Vishnu said this has cleared up the whole process behind clinical trials and how the review process is. No, but more importantly, how you can use it. This is how the session, what the session is meant for. How you can use the information that you interpret from these journal articles in your day-to-day practice as well as in future when you are looking for further information for updating yourselves on recent advances. So the next week's session would be a larger workshop, and final session would be on the 30th of December. That will be based on assignments which we'll be giving out in next week's workshop. So if there are no more doubts or no doubts or nothing to no clarifications, then we'll end the session here. Thank you very much for joining, and we will see you next week in the workshop. Thank you.